Hello everyone, in this video I would like to show you how to make this beautiful animation using GeoGebra, but before that we need to unveil the mathematics behind it. To understand what's going on, first let's remove all the circles except for the first one, and consider the center C1, the point P1, the find on the circle, and the radius R1, the distance of the segment C1 P1. Now scale down radius R1 to obtain the segment C2 P1, then draw a circle with center C2 that passes through the point P1. Therefore, we obtain a second circle that is tangent to the original one because both radii are aligned, and in this case P1 is the point of tangency. If we move point P1 around the first circle, we obtain the first part of the animation that we are looking for. To draw the next circle, let's move point P1 slightly up with respect of the horizontal radius of the first circle. Now, let P2 be a point on the second circle, draw the segment C2 P2, here we can name it R2, scale it down to obtain the segment C3 P2, and draw the circle center at C3, passing through P2. Here we obtain a third circle tangent to the second circle. We also need to define the movement of P2. In this case, P2 revolves at twice the speed of P1, as you can see here. Next, we plot a third circle, tangent to the previous one, with center C4 and radius C4, P3, ensuring that point P3 rotates 3 times faster than point P1, and the radius R3 is a scale factor of R2, maintaining the recursive pattern. The subsequent circles are constructed using this recursive process, and we continue adding as many as we like, or even at infinitum. This geometric construction is quite simple, but if we want to create our animation, we will need more information. In this case, we need to figure out the radius and the coordinates of the center for each circle. Let's find the radii first. Set C1 P1 equal to R1. The circle center at C2 has radius R2, the distance from C2 to P2. Since R2 is a scale factor of R1, we have that R2 is equal to R1 times S, where S is the scale factor. Now, the circle center at C3 has radius R3, which is equal to R2 times S. And R2 is equal to R1 times S, so we obtain R1 times S squared. We continue with this process to obtain the general case Rn equal to R1 times S to the power of n minus 1. Here, S is greater than 0 and less than 1. Now, before finding the centers, first consider the following equation. This implies that C1 C2 is equal to R1 minus C2 P1. We know the value of C2 P1 is equal to R1 times S, so this is equal to R1 minus R1 times S. Factoring, we have R1 times 1 minus S. Next, since R2 is equal to this expression, then C2 C3 is equal to R2 minus C3 P2, which is equal to R1 times S minus R1 times S squared, and factoring we obtain R1 times S times 1 minus S. C3 C4 is obtained in a similar way, which leads us to the general case Cn Cn plus 1 equal to R1 times S to the power of n minus 1 times 1 minus S. Again, S is greater than 0 and less than 1. Now that we know the length of the segment Cn Cn plus 1, we can find the coordinates of each point Cn. Set point C1 equal to 0, 0, the origin. The point C2 has the following Cartesian coordinates, where R1 times 1 minus S is the length of C1, C2, that is R1 times 1 minus S, and theta is the counterclockwise angle that is made with the point P1, the origin C1, and the x-axis, representing here with the dash segment. Here, theta is between 0 and 2 pi. We can rewrite this point using the polar form just to simplify the notation. So we have obtained the polar coordinates of C2. The polar coordinates of the next point C3 is the sum of two points. The first has radius R1 times 1 minus S and angle theta. The second has radius R1 times S times 1 minus S and angle 2 times theta. Now the point C4 is going to be the sum of the previous two points plus an extra point, This new point has radius r1 times s squared times 1 minus s and angle 3 theta. Following this pattern, we can find the general case Cn, written here using the sigma notation. Thus, we have obtained the radius and center of each circle, where s is greater than 0 and less than 1, and theta is between 0 and 2 pi. We can also assume that r1 is equal to 1 to simplify the expressions. Alright, now that we know all this information, we can build this animation using GeoGebra. So let's go to GeoGebra.org and we're going to open the main calculator. Here I'm going to adjust a little bit the input and also the axis just to have a better view. Now the first thing that I want to do is to define the scale factor as s equal to a slider from a 0.1 all the way to, let's say, 1.5 with an increment of 0.01. Now what I want to do is also to define the angle theta. So that is going to be t equal to a slider from 0 to 2 pi with an increment of 0.01. And that's it. So this is going to represent my angle and I have my scale factor. I'm going to define also an n equal to a slider from 0 all the way to 50 with an increment of 1. And this slider is going to determine how many circles I'm going to plot on my animation. Now I'm going to define a list ln equal to 0 dot 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 n, and this is going to produce a list of numbers that depends on the slider n. So for example, if n is equal to 10, I'm going to have 11 elements starting from 0 all the way to 10. Next, I define the list lr equal to the zip command. This is going to create a sequence. In this case, it's going to be the sequence of radii. S to the power of k, where k is the variable and the variable belongs to the list ln. Now I need to define the list of polar points. I'm going to define it as lp equal to the zip. And here I'm going to define my polar point with radius s to the power of k times 1 minus s semicolon k plus 1 times t, where t is the angle theta, where k is the variable that belongs to the list ln. So here you can appreciate all the points being plotted, and if we move the slider, you can see how they rotate. With this list, we can actually compute the points cn because they are defined as the sum of these points defined as a sequence. Now I'm going to define the list ls using the zip command. Here I'm going to use the command sum to compute the sum of k elements from the list lp, where k is the variable that belongs to the list ln. This will create a sequence of centers cn. If we drag the slider, the sequence of points should rotate and contract around the origin, as you can see here. Something that you may notice is that the first element of the list ls seems to be undefined. The reason is that the variable k in the zip command should start at 1. And since we consider k an element of ln, which first element is 0, we need to adjust that. This is easy to solve since we just need to type ln plus 1. Now we have all the elements of the list well defined. Finally, we just need to plot all the circles. We can define these as a sequence using again the zip command. So we type lc equal to zip and we are going to use the circle command. Each circle has a center p and radius r, where p belongs to the list ls and r belongs to the list lr. This almost looks to what we're looking for, but there is an issue. If we change the value of t, notice that every circle moves around the origin. Also, when the scale factor changes, all the circles seem to change of position. In our constructions, we must have the first circle fixed to the origin. This is what is missing in the list lp that I defined previously. We can fix this issue by simply adding the origin in our list lp. We can do this by typing the command join, open curly brackets, and type the point 0, 0, comma, the sequence of polar points defined as before. Now let's add more circles to the list and also hide the centers. I'm going to put this slider down here, and this should give the animation that we were looking for. We can either drag the slider T or click on the little button play to animate automatically. Here is the GeoGebra script in case you want to reproduce the construction. By the way, it is also possible to build this animation using the spreadsheet in GeoGebra. If you want to learn how to do it, I recommend you to check Ben Sparks' YouTube channel, where he also discusses some mathematical properties related to the golden ratio. One advantage of using the spreadsheet in GeoGebra is that we can easily change the colors of the circles. You should try it. I find it fascinating that this simple animation allows us to explore different mathematical concepts such as rotations, dilations, circle tangency, Cartesian and polar coordinates, as well as recursive sequences and series. Even more surprising is the connection that it has with complex numbers. Before talking about this connection, first let's add a couple of elements in our animation. Let's plot all the centers and connect them with the line segments, creating this structure that resembles a mechanical arm. This animation is closely related to the geometric representation of the geometric series for complex numbers. Here is its finite version. Now let me show you what I mean. The applet on the right illustrates the geometrical representation of the partial sums of geometric series. Here set is a complex number, and I can move it around. When set is inside the unit circle, the series converges, outside it diverges. For now, we'll focus on the case where set is inside the unit circle. Let's plot the partial sums up to 500 terms and observe how the arm on the right side behaves as we move the point set around the origin. As you can appreciate, both arms move in a similar way. Now let's rewrite the geometric series considering the exponential form of a complex number, that is, r exponential of I theta, where r is the modulus and theta is the phase of set. With this in mind, we can easily compute set to the power of k, as you can see here. Then the sum from 0 to n of set to the power of k is equal to the sum from 0 to n of r to the power of k times exponential of I times a multiple of theta. So you might be wondering, how exactly are the points Cn related to the geometric series? In order to see the connection between these two expressions, let's rewrite them both in Cartesian form. In the expression for the points, also, notice that we have the factor 1 minus s, so we can factorize it. We also expand the sums in each expression. If we focus our attention on the corresponding components of each expression, we notice that both components are essentially weighted cosine and sine series, where the weight for each term is given by the power of a constant, and the angle k times theta increases linearly with the value of k. Of course, using directly the geometric series won't reproduce the same result. We just need to adjust it. First, multiply by the factor 1 over r minus 1 and add the term 1 minus 1 over r. As a little challenge, try to build the animation in GeoGebra using this approach. That is, considering set a complex number equal to r exponential I theta, where r is greater than 0 and less than 1, and theta is between 0 and 2 pi. If you get stuck, don't worry, I will add links in the description with the solution. By the way, I used GeoGebra for the initial construction not only because I enjoy working with it, but also because its built-in functions make it easy to create these with just a few lines of code. If you prefer, you can use other mathematical tools or programming languages to achieve similar results, such as Desmos or p5.js. Okay, that's it. Thanks for watching. If you like this video, please consider becoming a member in my Patreon, where you can have access to other cool learning resources or mathematical animations that I make with GeoGebra and other programming languages. Bye bye!
Thank you.